It's an honor to be here and a privilege to be here. Thank you, Dan. Thanks to the Innovation Center. Thanks to all the other speakers, particularly my neighbor and co-presenter Chris, who saved my life here tonight with this pointer. The title of my talk, Unbuilt Highways of the New York Capital District, and this is the other side of some of the presentation that you saw earlier tonight. I'm going to start with a few questions, and these are rhetorical questions, so don't answer because I have the answers later in the presentation. But how many of you have ever wondered why there is no exit 3 on the Northway? How many of you have wondered why the Corporate Woods Boulevard interchange is just as big as the commercial development that it supports? How many of you have wondered why exit 6 on I-90 in Albany near Arbor Hill, Northern Boulevard, is seemingly so overbuilt to connect Loudoun Road and Northern Boulevard with this, I call it the wedding cake of bridges? There's the aerial view of the same. So you've got Loudoun Road, Henry Johnson Boulevard, both fairly local urban streets with this interchange in between. How many of you had wondered until a few minutes ago why the Empire State Plaza access road goes underneath the parking lot and comes to a virtual dead end, turns 180 degrees, and goes back to Rensselaer? How many of you have wondered why there's a dead end at the end of the Dunn Memorial Bridge? A literal dead end, or actually a dead beginning because traffic's supposedly moving in the opposite direction. Well, the answer to that and the question of how many of you use the term alternate Route 7? Why is that? The answer to that and many others can be found on this map, the 1973 highway planning map. There are 23 different roads that are shown in this area: Troy, Albany, Rensselaer, Schenectady. The solid green lines are roads that were actually built. The dashed green lines are roads that, as of 1973, were committed and had funding associated with it and had a program in place to construct. And the orange were proposed in some way with no specific corridor, proposed as a corridor, but with no specific route or location identified. Of the 23 that are on here, I've counted a total of 4 that were actually built. And that would be 787, number eight on here, 787 that was previously critiqued. I-90 through Rensselaer County. I-88, which actually did not go in the route that's shown here, it connected to 890 further west. And what people, again, still will refer to as alternate Route 7, which is item number 10 here. What drove that map? Let's go back a couple of decades, 1956, President Eisenhower signed the authorization for the Interstate Highway to be completed. And what you see on that, this is indicative of the planning for the next 20 plus years of highway transportation in the United States. It changed from state highways that we had seen similar to Route 7, Route 5, to limited access highways, which were intended to connect urban centers. What you see on this map are a lot of words like Scranton and Albany and Plattsburgh and Kansas City and Las Cruces and a lot of urban centers. This interstate program was to connect those, but something that I've always felt got missed in all of that planning is once you get there, what do you do? Because every commute, every visit has a beginning and an end. And that's where the map that I had shown, here's a 1964 World's Fair model. Shows what highway planning and design looked like at that time. You see this road right here, you see a cloverleaf interchange, you see four six, eight lanes of traffic. This line right here is the reality of what was shown here on the model. And again, this was indicative of what the planning of highways looked like at that time. Coming back to the map, so this is the connections. You get off of 87, you get off of 90, you know, whether you're coming from the north, coming from the south, east, west, you get into the Capital District, then where do you go? And all of these highways were different ways and different means to get you to the local streets and to get you to your destinations off of the interstate highway. So let's go back to my questions. What I'm going to do is I've got six different items on that map that I'm going to talk about briefly in each one. I'm going to start at the airport, and in the topic of my conversation, kind of spiral around and to the outside of the Capital District. So starting at the airport, I-687. This is a map, Rand McNally Atlas from 1967, and it shows in dashed lines a I-687 through Colonie. And here is where it would have gone. This is Corporate Woods Boulevard. This is the interchange that gets to Corporate Woods Boulevard. That was intended to be the exit from I-90 that would go all the way to the airport, including a exit 3 on the Northway. Here is Wolf Road. Here's Sand Creek Road, here's Albany Shaker Road, right between the middle of all of that. Here is the crossing to Colonie. This is the disruption that would have happened from that, all the way through parallel and in between Albany Shaker Road and Sand Creek Road. But not only do we have I-687 that was proposed, there was a companion road, which was the extension of I-85, coming off of I-85, and continuing northerly, again, cutting right through, basically following Osborne Road and connecting to what would have been a new exit, another exit on I-687. So you can imagine all of the disruption to the homes that would have been done in this area. Next, let's move to what we heard about earlier with the Mid-Crosstown Arterial. Here is, in this case, we're looking north is to the right. And here is Loudonville Road, here is I-90, here is Loudon Road. And then right here, this Midtown Crosstown Arterial, this is roughly where Northern Boulevard, Henry Johnson Boulevard are now. Connecting on the other side, all the way through downtown to another end on the south that would connect to exit 23 on the thruway. This was a straight through all the way from exit 23 on the thruway, continuing north to exit 6 on what's now I-90. And in the middle of all of that, here is Empire State Plaza. The hairpin turn is right here. What was planned is it would continue westbound through what is now the Center Square neighborhood, continue, and this was originally intended, as we heard, to be a surface road that would have, again, devastated that corridor where Center Square is now. And then it was intended to go underground under Washington Park with a couple of loops and ramps that would get you, again, either north or south. And that's what it would have looked like, where all of the dark would have been surface roads, and then some underground under the park. So again, you can imagine all along that route that was connecting exit 23 and I-90, exit 6. And there's a rendering of a model that was done at the time, again, showing here's the underground, and here would have been the surface area through where Center Square neighborhood is in Albany. And if you look at the other end, you will see there's our ring at 787 and Dunn Memorial Bridge. What was intended, Dunn Memorial Bridge was going to continue eastbound through Rensselaer. The train station, as it is today, sits right here on this green line. it was going to continue and then sweep up and meet with what is now exit 8 on I-90 in DeFreeceville. And that's what it would have done, coming through the city of Rensselaer and then coming around and hooking through East Greenbush and North Greenbush. That was the South Mall Expressway. Let's continue north. Here's the Menands Bridge. Here is Troy. Here is Lansingburg. There was an intent that was going to parallel 787. This was called the Troy North-South Corridor, and it was intended to connect the Menands Bridge to Hoosick Street. And I haven't seen a specific route on it that showed a lot of disruption in the lower part here, but eventually it does come right down the spine of the city of Troy running north. But there was also an extension on that that would have went right down the middle of Lansingburg and come up and connected in Spiegeltown. These, we just heard about the Garnet Baltimore design of the boulevards on 6th and 7th Street, or 6th and 7th in Lansingburg section, is right here. All of that corridor would have been replaced with an arterial highway. It never happened. Here's a part of a plan that shows this right here is what became the Collar City Bridge off of Hoosick Street. The only part of what's shown in green and yellow here that was proposed that was actually built. South of it, this is what would have been the north-south connector, and north of it would have been the extension, which again ran up to and through Lansingburg. Okay, so going again north on this is to the right, looking up, this is westward, and this is the Collar City Bridge, which on this map shows up here. This is what, again, is often known as Alternate 7, which does not exist anymore. Alternate 7 was named Alternate 7 in the 80s because Route 7 used to go through Waterfleet, which is Route 2 now. So the Route 2 section in Waterfleet used to be Route 7. What was intended was a complete alternate Route 7 that would go from Troy, continue beyond Latham, all the way around towards Schenectady and connect to I-90 at the where I-90 and 890 are right now at exit 25. This part of alternate 7 never got built. As a result of that, what was being called alternate 7 was changed to be just Route 7, and Route 2 was or Route 7 was renamed as Route 2 in the Waterfleet. Again, another very large swath that was not built. And then the last one, and this is the perhaps the longest one that was on that, this was called the Selkirk-Schenectady route. This was a concept to completely bypass all of the Capital District by connecting right now where I think it's exit 21A, 22. In Selkirk.
22.
And connecting and all the way back up to 890, that same interchange of where exit 25 is now, and bypassing all of the Capital District. Again, not completed. This one didn't make it. I don't even know if this one made it to the drawing board. This might not have made it out of the planning manual. But what do all of those look like compiled? And again, this is just six of those 23 routes that I've shown on the previous map, but just those six that I spoke about alone, 687 and 85 extension, the Mid-Crosstown Arterial, the South Mall Expressway, the Troy North-South Connector, Alternate 7, and the Schenectady route. As you can see, would have made a huge difference as to what we have today in the Capital District. Why did these happen? I think it's a combination of these were all begun to be planned in the 1950s, 1960s, into the 70s, when the mindset of the interstate was very much had taken hold among planners, engineers. And what happened in the early 60s is historic preservation movement with Penn Station being replaced, the historic preservation movement really started taking hold. Also, in the 60s and early 70s, you started seeing urban renewal being seen as a failure. And so there was a mindset that started looking back to the downtowns, looking back to the homes, looking back to the historic fabric of communities. And I think that had a lot to do with the change of you know, why did 787 go in, but the North-South connector didn't? Yeah, I think it was a combination of those things happening. And then eventually it was money. But by the 1970s, most of these were canceled. But I think the driver of it is the appreciation that people started looking at community and pedestrians at least equal to the needs of the vehicles. And that would be my opinion on why these were left on the drawing board.